So once the development of the plate is over, we have to locate the solutes. So what distance in individual solutes have moved up over the surface of the TLC plate. So this will be done in usually five ways. The first way is you just take out the TLC plate from the chamber, and you, if the TLC plate is having the spots of organic compounds, then it is usually sprayed with the solution of sulfuric acid. And other way is keeping the TLC plate in a chamber containing few crystals of iodine. These two reagents are having the capability to react with the organic compounds. After the reaction is over, they will make the compounds to visualize the dark products. Some colored spots we can see where the solute are present. If the solute is moved to a particular distance and this sulfuric acid or iodine is reacted with those solutes, the spots moved by the solute will be imparted by the colored spots. So these dark or colored spots are the solute spots. And even nonhydrin. Nonhydrin is a selective reagent because it has a very good selective reactivity with most of the organic compounds to react with a dark purple colored spot. When nonhydrin react with many organic compounds, so it will produce a dark colored product, and that dark colored spot will be seen over the surface of the TLC plate, and this reagent is going to be very useful. And other way is use of fluorescent agent. While preparing the stationary phase, while preparing the aqueous slurry of the stationary phase, you will mix a fluorescent material such as fluorescein or rhodamine B, etc. Any other fluorescent material you can use. You take the stationary phase, binder and fluorescent material, prepare the aqueous slurry and place over the TLC plate. You dry it and you can use it as a stationary phase. If an organic compound moved over the surface of the TLC plate, at the spot at which the organic compound is present, the fluorescent radiation of the fluorescent material is going to be quenched by the organic compound. So if you keep the fluorescent plate or the TLC plate into a UV chamber, throughout the plate there will be glowing of light radiation because the fluorescent material is present. But exactly at the spot at which the organic compound is present, the color will not be imparted. And that is because the quenching of the fluorescent or quenching of the fluorescent process by this organic compound. So you are able to locate the spot where exactly quenching has been taken place. So these are the ways how to locate the solute points over the TLC plate. One is by using sulfuric acid or iodine for spraying purpose. You can spray sulfuric acid over the TLC plate. Even iodine can also be sprayed. Permanganate can be sprayed. Other reagents, I will also explain what are the other reagents which are used in order to locate the solute particles over the TLC plate. And nonhydrin can be used. And fluorescent materials such as fluorescein or rhodamine B dyes can be used because they are highly fluorescent and they emit different colors at different wavelengths when we subject it for UV exposure. Okay, you can see here three pictures: fluorescein dye and rhodamine. At shorter wavelength and longer wavelength, assume these are the two dyes. These are the two dyes. When you use these two dyes for a solute detection, and if you expose them to the UV light radiation of shorter wavelength or longer wavelength, the solutes wherever present here, you can see here two spots, the solutes wherever present. So solutes have quenched the TLC plate, therefore all over the TLC plate it is colored. All over the TLC plate it is colored. At the spot where the solute molecules are present, the spots are different in color when compared to this green background, when compared to this blue background. So therefore, these dyes are going to be very useful. So when you expose any aromatic compound to UV light, colors first can be seen. When you expose any aromatic compound, any organic aromatic compound to the UV light, some compounds will impart color spots. So you just take PLC plate and you put it in UV chamber. If you look at by means of the window, you can see a color spot wherever a certain degree of unsaturation or conjugation is extended in that aromatic compound. You can see color spot. Iodine is used because it has the ability to oxidize the aromatic compounds. Most of the aromatic compounds will have the ability to undergo oxidation. Iodine crystals you are going to use as a developing reagent. Iodine is a strong oxidizing agent. So iodine will oxidize the aromatic compounds. So under the oxidized state, the spots will become colored. Because when they undergo oxidation, the modification of the structural formula takes place. As a result of this modification, the color also may be changed. Colorless to color or color to colorless, whatever it is. Likewise, instead of sulfuric acid or iodine, even we can use para-anisaldehyde as a developing reagent, because many aldehydes, ketones and alcohols are going to react with para-anisaldehyde in order to impart color spots. So even in place of para-anisaldehyde, vanillin can also be used for aldehydes, ketones and alcohols, because these are selective reagents in order to react with aldehydes, ketones and alcohols. After the reaction is over, the reaction products between para-anisaldehyde or vanillin with the organics like aldehydes, ketones and alcohols will be colored. So that color spots will be seen when these reagents are used as developing solvents. Here I have presented the three diagrams, three pictures. A, B, C, D. To concentrate on these three pictures, A is to show the structure of para-anisaldehyde and vanillin. These are the two reagents which are used as developing solvents. TLC technique is used for the separation of four compounds, namely 4-heptanone, acetophenone, cinnamaldehyde and the ethyl benzoate. These four compounds are present in a sample. We are going to use TLC technique for the separation of these four compounds, and we will use different development techniques for the detection of the solutes, 4-heptanone, acetophenone, cinnamaldehyde and ethyl benzoate. Whatever the TLC mobile phase you use, whatever the stationary phase you use, don't worry about that. After the separation is over, we have to locate the solute spot. For locating the solute spot, we will use UV exposure, para-anisaldehyde and vanillin. Three different ways we are going to employ. We are exposing the TLC plate into UV chamber. We are using para-anisaldehyde reagent and we also use vanillin. Okay. When you expose the TLC plate, after the development is over, you can see only three spots. Here, the first spot is for acetophenone. Second spot is for cinnamaldehyde. Third spot is for ethyl benzoate. Acetophenone, cinnamaldehyde, and ethyl benzoate. 4-heptanone is not aromatic. 4-heptanone is not aromatic. It is an aliphatic ketone. Because of the absence of conjugation, UV exposure is not going to give you appropriate result. So, 4-heptanone, even it is present over the TLC plate, it is invisible when you expose that to the UV chamber because it is not conjugated molecule. Okay. When you use para-anisaldehyde as a development solvent, development reagent, para-anisaldehyde reacted with 4-heptanone, acetophenone, and cinnamaldehyde. 4-heptanone, acetophenone, and cinnamaldehyde. So, if you take vanillin, 4-heptanone, acetophenone, okay, 4-heptanone and acetophenone, you can see very clearly. But here there is no color. Means cinnamaldehyde is not going to yield any color spot after reacting with vanillin. But here, 4-heptanone, acetophenone, and cinnamaldehyde, all three compounds are going to yield colored spots after reacting with para-anisaldehyde. So this gives you the confirmation that both the reagents are selective for all 4-heptanone and acetophenone. Both the reagents are selective colorants for 4-heptanone and acetophenone. Both the reagents are non-selective colorants for ethyl benzoate. See here, ethyl benzoate is moved up to this particular point. You can see by means of UV imparting. So ethyl benzoate is present here, but here no spot is seen for ethyl benzoate. Here also no spot is seen for ethyl benzoate, but some spots are seen, and these may be due to impurities. We don't know about those impurities. Para-anisaldehyde is a selective reagent for cinnamaldehyde. Here, cinnamaldehyde react with para-anisaldehyde to give a colored, dark colored spot. So, this is going to be a selective reagent for the detection of para-anisaldehyde. So, what is the outcome of this particular slide? The developing solvents, all are not suitable for all those solutes which are present in the sample. Some developing solvent will be used for the detection of some solutes, and we can change the developing solvent or the development technique for the detection of other solutes. So this is very clear to explain that how the solutes are going to be located by means of the reagents such as para-anisaldehyde, vanillin, iodine, sulfuric acid, nonhydrin, or by exposing the TLC plate into UV chamber. Okay. Once the separation is over, it is very, very important to study about the characteristics and the quantity of the solute present in the sample. So, in order to do that, we need certain parameters. What are those parameters? Okay, let us go back, take a TLC plate, introduce the sample on the imaginary line which is created by a pencil. So, this is going to be the starting point. Once the sample is introduced at this imaginary line, and the TLC plate is immersed into the solvent, the solute has moved a particular distance from this particular point. This is going to be the distance. Not only solute has moved, but also mobile phase. Mobile phase will also move upward. So, we will measure the distance from the line drawn by the pencil to the mobile phase front. This is called as mobile phase front or the solvent front. Just assume this is going to be the distance x in centimeter, and the distance moved by the solute from the spot is y centimeter. So this distance moved by the solute is because the ability of the solute to get retarded over the stationary phase surface means the solute has some affinity towards the stationary phase, and there is an interaction taking place between the solute and the stationary phase. Therefore, while mobile phase is moving, dependent upon the ability or the extent of the tightness of the interaction or the binding of the interaction between the solute and the stationary phase, the speed of the migration of the solute can be expected. Therefore, the solute has moved up to this particular point. So, the distance moved by the solvent is x centimeter, and the distance moved by the solute is y centimeter. So, retardation factor is a very important parameter in thin layer chromatography. This is going to be the characteristic parameter for the solute. Whatever the solute present, its characteristic will be measured by means of the retardation factor. It is not used to measure the quantity of the solute. Retardation factor, denoted by RF, is used to measure the characteristic feature of the solute. That's it. So, what is this retardation factor? RF is simply the ratio of the distance moved by the solute, y in centimeter or millimeter, over the distance moved by the mobile phase in centimeter or millimeter. So retardation factor is denoted by RF, is denoted as, it is the ratio of the distance traveled by the solute over the distance traveled by the mobile phase of the solvent. RF is equal to distance moved by the solute divided by distance moved by the mobile phase. So, for a single component system, it is okay. So, you can see a single spot and you can measure the RF. Similarly, for the double component system also, you can measure the distance traveled by solute A. So this is going to be the point at which the sample has been spotted. You will measure the distance from the center of the solute spot to the center of the sample spot. You will measure the distance moved by solute A. Similarly, you will measure the distance moved by solute B here from the center to this particular center. If this is symmetrical, no problem. If this is unsymmetrical, you can locate the point where the density is maximum, and that point will be used to calculate the distance from this particular point. So sample 1 and sample 2. Sample 1 is containing two solutes and sample 2 is containing only one solute. Dependent upon the number of solutes present in the sample, as many number of spots you can see over the TLC plate. So you should remember about the solvent front, distance moved by the solute, and with respect to solvent front, distance moved by the mobile phase. And the retardation factor is dr by dm, where dr is the distance moved by the solute. For solute A here, this is going to be dra, and for this particular solute, this is going to be drb, and for this solute, this is going to be dr. So distance moved by the solute divided by distance moved by the mobile phase is nothing but the retardation factor. This value of RF will be ranging from 0 to 1. You will be very clear, if the value of RF is 1, the solute is not going to be retarded, and it is moving faster along with the mobile phase. Means the characteristic of the solute is matched with the mobile phase, therefore it is moving along with the mobile phase. It is retained by the mobile phase. If RF is 0, the value of RF is 0, the binding ability of the solute towards the stationary phase is very, very high, very, very great. There is a greater binding ability of the solute with the stationary phase if the value of RF is 0. So, should remember, the range of RF value is from 0 to 1. 1 is for showing the solute unretardation, and 0 for showing the greater ability to interact with the stationary phase. You can see here a simple example to how the RF values. Take a mixture of benzaldehyde and benzyl alcohol. Take a mixture and you are going to separate them by using the mobile phase of 7:3 pentane and diethyl ether. 7:3 pentane and diethyl ether. To take the mixture, you create a line, spot a drop of the sample over the TLC plate, and immerse this TLC plate into a TLC chamber containing the solvent 7:3 pentane and diethyl ether. So after some interval of time, you can see the separation of benzaldehyde and benzyl alcohol. Benzaldehyde and benzyl alcohol. Mobile phase has moved a distance of 5 cm. Benzyl alcohol has moved a distance of 1.5 cm. Benzaldehyde has moved a distance of 3.2 cm. So these are the structures of these two compounds. You have distance moved by the mobile phase, distance moved by the benzaldehyde, and distance moved by benzyl alcohol. So simply calculate the RF value. RF value for benzaldehyde is going to be 3.25 is the distance moved by the benzaldehyde divided by 5 cm is the distance moved by the mobile phase. The RF value is going to be 0.64. Similarly, benzyl alcohol, RF value will be 1.5 divided by 5, you are going to get 0.3. So this is how we can calculate the RF value. Similarly, calculation of RF value for two solutes where the mobile phase has moved 12 cm, solute 1 has moved 2.9 cm and solute 2 has moved 8.3 cm. You can calculate the RF value of solute 1 and solute 2, and the obtained value will be 0.24 and 0.69. This RF value will be unitless, it is dimensionless, but it will be ranging from 0 to 1. Okay, so apart from RF, retardation factor, we are also required with the time taken by the solute and the mobile phase. So mobile phase will be moving a distance of dm centimeter, and the solute will be moving a distance of dr centimeter. So you assume the time taken by the solute and the mobile phase to travel the distance of dr and dm centimeter will be tr and tm respectively. The time taken by the solute and the mobile phase to travel the distance dr and tm are denoted by tr and tm. Okay, let me write the time taken by the mobile phase to travel the distance dr is written as dr by u, where u is the velocity of the mobile phase. I could have written here dm, but I have written dr. Why? And similarly, tr is equal to dm by u. The time taken by the solute to travel the distance dm is written as tr is equal to dm by u. Why I have interchanged here dr by dm and dm by dr? Because here, during the elution process, mobile phase is moving a distance dm and the solute is moving a distance dr. This two movement of the solute and the mobile phase will be taking place parallelly, simultaneously. So solute will not travel the distance of dr until mobile phase has traveled a distance dm. Solute will also be moving. Mobile phase has to travel a distance dm. So until mobile phase traveled distance dm, solute will travel a distance dr. Or until the solute traveled a distance dr, mobile phase will travel a distance dm. So time taken by the solute or the mobile phase to travel the distance dr or dm will be same. That's what tm is equal to dr by u and tr is equal to dm by u. You can see here, these are the chromatograms. When a detector is placed at the end of the TLC plate and in situ detection is made, these are going to be the chromatogram. When you consider a two component system, solute B is traveled a very less distance. So chromatogram for solute B and solute A has traveled longer distance and the chromatogram for solute A. And this is the distance between solute A and solute B. This is going to give you, is there any clear separation taken place? Is there any overlapping? Is there any overlapping between the peaks of two solutes, etc.? So resolution is measured by means of this gap delta Z. Okay, now you have Tm is equal to dr by u, Tr is equal to dm by u. We know the capacity factor. Capacity factor in column chromatography can be written as retention time minus dead time divided by dead time. We know that. In column chromatography, we will use the retention time, that is time taken by the solute to reach the detector after the introduction of the sample to the head of the chromatographic column. Here, TR is the time taken by the solute to travel a distance dr. TR is the time taken by the solute to travel a distance dr at a velocity u. Is the optimum velocity of the mobile phase. So instead of retention time, we will use the time taken by the solute to travel a distance dr. So tr minus dm is the time taken by the mobile phase to travel a distance dm, or vice versa, divided by tm. You have tr is equal to dm by u and tm is equal to dr by u. You just substitute here, tr and tm will be getting dm minus dr divided by dr. If you substitute dm by u in place of tr and dr by u in place of tm, you will get an equation k is equal to dm minus dr divided by dr, where k is the capacity factor or retention factor. So this expresses the relative migration of the solute over the TLC plate, not in the column, over the TLC plate. You consider this equation. You divide both the numerator and denominator by dm. This whole thing divided by dm and this whole thing divided by dm. So k is equal to dm by dm minus dr by dm divided by dr by dm. Dm by dm is 1. So 1 minus dr by dm divided by dr by dm. You know, from the previous slide, dr by dm is going to be RF value, retardation factor, distance moved by the solute divided by distance moved by the mobile phase. You are going to get the retardation factor. So the retention factor is linked to the retardation factor here. So the retardation factor is used to express the capacity factor or retention factor of the solute. You should remember this equation. The retention factor or capacity factor of solute in TLC is simply K is equal to 1 minus RF divided by RF. And the column efficiency is as usually expressed by using the term N, number of theoretical plates. It is denoted by the equation N is equal to 16 dr squared divided by W squared. We don't use time taken by the solute, but we will use distance moved by the solute. So 16 dr squared divided by W squared instead of 16 tr squared divided by W squared in column chromatography. Similarly, the height of a theoretical plate is denoted as dr by N. Distance traveled by the solute divided by number of theoretical plates is going to give you the height of the theoretical plate. So the plate efficiency is expressed by the number of theoretical plates and height of a theoretical plate. As the value of N is more, the value of dr should be more, or the W will be less. Similarly, H, as the value of H is to be less, dr should be less. So the number of theoretical plates and height are used to express the efficiency of the separation by thin layer chromatography. Okay. So this is about the detection of the solute and the parameters what we will use in order to characterize the solute. So you have a TLC plate developed and you have identified the solute. What are the ways to identify and quantify the solute which is present in the sample? Identification will be done by simply matching the RF value. How do we match the RF value? Just take the TLC plate, place the sample as a one spot, and place a standard you are suspecting to be present that compound in the sample. To take a standard means a compound you are suspecting that compound to be present in the sample. So at one spot you place a drop of the standard, at the other spot you place a drop of the sample. You develop the plate, identify the spot. If the standard spot is matching with the solute spot from the sample, you can assume the solute may be as same as the standard. Or you can calculate the RF value. If the RF value of the standard is matching with the RF value of the solute from the sample, you can conclude that the sample is containing the solute, what I have taken separately to calculate the RF value. This is for identification. And identification is also done by utilizing the spot over the TLC plate. Solute spot is present. You remove that solute spot by scraping by means of razor blade or a spatula. You remove that spot. And you collect that in a paper, glazing paper. You dissolve that in a suitable solvent. And that may also be contained with stationary phase. You remove the stationary phase by centrifugation or filtration. If the stationary phase particle is having larger size, you can remove that by filtration. Otherwise, centrifugation may be required. You take the supernatant and subject it for spectroscopic investigation such as UV visible or NMR or MAS or IR or fluorescent spectrometric. So these spectroscopic techniques you employ and you identify what is the solute present. Characterization techniques you can employ and you can study. As I told you, mass spectrometric detector will be directly coupled with the TLC instrument so that the final display given by the instrument is a function of the solute present in the sample. So identification will be done primarily by RF matching. You will calculate the RF value for the standard as well as the solute from the sample. Otherwise, you can use other spectroscopic technique by subjecting the solution of the sample, which was prepared by scraping the solute spot either from the razor blade or the spatula and dissolving in a suitable solvent by eliminating the stationary phase either by centrifugation or filtration into spectroscopic techniques. Quantification can also be done. So here you can see a paper, a sample is spotted. It is containing many solutes after the immersion of the TLC paper into the solvent, after some duration of the time, you can see here the movement of the solute molecules can be seen, where the movement is only one direction, it has not spread. Why? Now to make the direction of the movement of the solute into this particular way. This is very important. This is done by two-dimensional TLC. What do you mean by this two-dimensional TLC? You can look at the separation principle here. As the name is implying, two-dimensional TLC means two mobile phases are used here. Two solvents are going to be used. Very simple procedure is employed here. You take a TLC plate, prepare the sample solution, spot a sample over a line at one corner. Immerse this plate into a single solvent. It may be a mixture of two solvents, it may be a mixture of three solvents, whatever it is. This is going to be solvent A, assume solvent A. So the solutes present in the sample, what you have introduced, I have showed the migration like this in this particular solvent. Okay, now the separation is over, but not yet completed. Not yet completed, the complete resolution of the solute is not completed. So this is solvent A. Next, you rotate this plate clockwise to an angle 90 degree, like this. Rotate this paper clockwise to an angle 90 degree. Of course, you have to dry the plate. You have to eliminate the solvent because this plate will be wet because of the solvent sticking. How to evaporate this solvent by drying. Then you rotate this plate to an angle 90 degree clockwise. Then you immerse this plate again into some other solvent. Some other solvent. You can see here, differential migration of the solutes. Here exactly the solute part was made. The solutes have been spread according to their own migration. So solute movement has been initiated here and the solute movement has been completed here. This is called as two-dimensional thin layer chromatographic technique. So here two solvents are used and the solutes are eluted in those two solvents. First solvent for the initiation of the separation, where clear separation or complete separation of the solute will be impossible. And by using the second solvent, we can spread the separation of the solute appropriately. A simple example I can present here, solvent A and solvent B for the separation of these 10 amino acids. By using toluene 2-chloroethanol pyridine solvent, it is solvent A, and chloroform benzyl alcohol acetic acid, it is a solvent B. 10 amino acids are present. No other techniques are suitable for the separation of these 10 amino acids apart from TLC. So what you do, you just take solvent A or solvent B, whatever it is. If you're going to take solvent B, just place a drop of the sample containing these 10 amino acids or mixture of these 10 amino acids. You just put a sample, immerse into solvent B or solvent A. Immerse into solvent B and solvent A first. Then you elute in the ascending manner. Elute in the ascending manner means the amino acids will start to migrate with respect to their relative affinity towards the first solvent into which you are immersed, the TLC plate. Next, once the movement of the mobile phase to two-third of its overall length, you remove the plate out, then you dry the solvent, rotate the TLC plate to an angle 90 degree, then you immerse into other solvent. Perform the elution process. You can see clear separation of amino acid, aspartic acid, glutamic acid, serine, beta-alanine, glycine, alanine, methionine, valine, isoleucine, etc. Like this, two-dimensional TLC is going to be a very useful technique for the separation of the solutes that are present in the sample. Whenever the multi-component systems are present, it is very easy to perform the separation by two-dimensional TLC, particularly for the separation of amino acids. So here, two-dimensional separation of coumarin derivatives have been performed. Around 15 coumarin derivatives were present in a sample. All those 15 coumarin derivatives were not able to be separated by one-dimensional TLC, but it can be achieved by two-dimensional TLC by using two different stationary phases. You can see here silica and reverse phase, modified silica, polar silica, non-polar silica. So not only the solvents can be interchanged, solvents can be changed in two-dimensional TLC, but also the material, stationary phase material can also be changed. Polar stationary phase can be used in which all those non-polar solutes are retarded, not retarded. And non-polar stationary can be used for retarding non-polar stationary phases. You can see the separation. So this is about two-dimensional TLC. We shall move on to HPTLC later.